Thank you for calling Late Night Taco Delivery. If you are calling to place an order, unfortunately the store is closed due to the fact that we are about to record a podcast. We'll be closed for another half an hour-ish. If you're calling to listen to the show, congratulations, you are just in time. So kick back, relax, and enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, children of all ages, welcome to Late Night Taco Delivery.
Late Night Taco Delivery! Yay!
Yay! I am your host, Daniel Gill.
And I'm Jonathan Knoll.
And we're here to talk about nerd stuff.
As always.
As always. So how are you doing, sir?
So far, so good. This last week, I've been learning all the tricks and trades of cashiering. And, you know, that's all fun and good. Mm-hmm. And, I'm also working on converting my VHS versions of the Star Wars Trilogy Special Edition from VHS to DVD, because the 97 versions do count.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah.
I never actually saw that in the theater. I never got to see the entire A New Hope in the theaters, because, I went to see it in Orlando, and the, film broke.
Yeah, I remember you saying that.
Yeah. So it's like, well, poop. So I've never actually seen Alderaan blow up.
That's too bad. I mean, really, it's not that noticeable at first.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's just a little ring around it. Big whoop.
Ah.
But yeah, there was also another thing called Zombalania, I think. I'd have to look.
Zombomania?
Zombalania, I think, is what it's called.
Oh, okay. What is it, though?
Oh, Zombalenium. Excuse me. It's a comic book that is on its way to becoming a new movie.
Oh, okay.
And it's French. It looks fantastic. Basically, you have a bunch of, scary monsters, in a horror theme park. Okay. You know, just working.
Yeah.
I'll link it to the website, to the Facebook.
Cool. Another thing I've been doing this month is on my Facebook, I've been, every day I do two pieces of animation, calling this animation.
Oh, yeah, I've been following that. It's really cool.
Yeah, and basically I'm finding a lot of obscure stuff or things from other countries. And don't get me wrong, I have been putting in, like, you know, Disney and Warner Brothers and such, but I'm trying to introduce all my friends on Facebook to something different, you know?
Right.
Try a little bit different, you know, some Japanese animation from pre-World War II, mm-hmm. some French zombie animation.
I noticed Gorillaz was in there.
I used Gorillaz because they're one of the most successful virtual bands ever.
And that was really cool, too.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoyed the tirade of people who I really like this one, or I like this one. It was really cool.
Yeah, like, well, why didn't you choose that song? Because I wanted to do the first one that's representative of what they do. And, you know, it was the first song I ever heard the Gorillaz do, so why not?
Fair enough.
Yep.
First one I remember is, of course, Feel Good.
Mm-hmm.
And, after that, my history with the Gorillaz goes, Feel Good is on the radio for forever,
mm-hmm.
and then suddenly it stops, and I just lose complete track of Gorillaz.
Ah.
Then, like, 2 years ago, there's a guy who I was watching on the internet, and he's like, Demon Days is one of the most influential albums I've ever heard. And I'm like, I need to give this Demon Days album a shot.
Yes.
So, lo and behold, I have all of their albums.
Hmm. What else have I been doing? I've been doing nothing interesting. Actually, I take that back. I went to see Welcome to Night Vale last night.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. How did that go?
It was actually pretty cool. I was surprised about how many people actually showed up to it. Well, I mean, obviously, the audience was huge. And it was at the Fillmore, which is in Detroit, which is right across from Ford Field, where the Detroit Tigers play. And, of course, they were having a home game last night, so traffic was a bitch.
Mm.
But went in. Big. We had nosebleed seats, but we still could see everything. The sound was really good. They had a singer named Kate Epworth, I think. She was tonight's weather.
Hmm.
And she did a mini set, about 5 or 6 songs, and then they had Cecil come out, and he basically did a radio play, and they had Joseph Fink, the producer, and Aspiration, Disparition was playing the music. But I was actually very surprised about all the voice actors that came with the traveling show. They had the guy who did Carlos, they had the guy who did, the student...
Oh.
I just had it. Trinity or something like that.
The one who's obsessed with books?
The one who's obsessed with books and face down a librarian, yeah.
Damn it, I feel bad. I don't remember.
Yeah, I knew it earlier. But she came out, and she was a very sweet young lady, and was just, you could tell she was so excited to be there.
That's Astrid from Fringe.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. And the one that actually surprised me was Mara Wilson was there as the voice of the faceless little lady who lives in your home.
Yes. When I first heard that episode and heard that Mara Wilson was the faceless old woman who lives in your house, I was just like, oh my god, Mara Wilson is just too awesome. Because she is. She fucking is, man.
Well, I'm kind of glad that they did not have Will Wheaton on the stage as well, because I probably would have stage dived. Like, oh my god, Wesley, dive! You know, everyone looks up in slow motion as, like, I'm flying off the third store balcony, aiming towards him with my arms wide, just get to see Will Wheaton's eyes open very briefly before I plaster him with a giant hug.
Now I want to see this in slow motion, just do 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 do. Just, you know, Chariots of Fire and all that. Whoosh. Suddenly you have the long flowing locks of Dan coming forth, Will Wheaton's eyes widen, and then suddenly...
Squish. And the last thing that Will Wheaton hears is, we'll be together forever.
As your neck snaps.
Yeah, exactly. But no, it was a fun little show. They did ask no audio or video recording because they said that this is the same show they're going to be they'll be showing this all over the country. And when it's done, they'll record it as an actual podcast. They just want to make sure that everyone gets a chance to hear it, which I thought was a cool idea.
Yeah, that's really awesome, actually.
Their merchandise table was really boring, though. I was kind of disappointed. I only had 2 t-shirts and a poster. I'm like, where's the coffee mugs? Where's the decals? What's going on, guys?
Well, that takes shipping.
Bah! They have cars. Rent a panel van. Put free candy on the side. You'd be all set.
Yes. Free candy. Or, moreover, or more like, listeners, there's free candy to be had in the back.
There's free candy in the dog park.
Everyone should go into the dog park.
Yeah, don't listen to the fake Cecil. Do not go to the dog park.
You should totally go to the dog park. I mean, it's a pretty good idea. If you really think about it.
It's an awful idea. Do not listen to the fake Cecil. Do not go to the dog park. The Sheriff's Secret Police ask you, please, do not go to the dog park. They are too busy fighting the librarians to stop you. All right, anyway.
Right. No, actually, you're not the only friend of mine that actually went up to see Night Vale last night.
Oh, really?
Yeah, my friend, who is I'm a student over at University of Michigan.
Okay.
Also went.
Yeah, well, I would be very surprised if I was the only one from Bowling Green that went.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was fun. I was kind of disappointed though. On the way home, we stopped at Popeye's Chicken, and I got a really crappy meal, which is the first time I've ever been to Popeye's and not had good food. So. I was like, I look forward to Popeye's, and it was sucky. But then again, we got there 10 minutes before they closed.
Yeah, that's going to happen.
And they were like, we just want to go home. We don't want to make any more food. And I'm like, okay, I'll take what you've got. That's exactly what happened. Anyway, fun show.
Yeah, beggars and choosers. Right. So beyond that, I've already spilled what I'm geeking out about. What are you geeking out about?
Welcome to Night Vale.
All right, fair enough.
That's pretty much all I've been doing. I'm almost finished with His Dark Materials.
Ooh.
Which is the series I've been reading.
And how's that going?
Pretty well. It's very dark, but a lot of interesting ideas are being raised. Apparently, the author really hates organized religion.
Go ahead.
The entire book is basically about declaring war on heaven.
Hmm.
Yeah, that's what basically it's all boiling down to. So, aw.
Yeah, I'll have to give it a read sometime.
Hmm. I mean, it's very imaginative, got some really, really cool stuff in it.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that, yay.
Yep. So shall we go on to our geek news?
We shall.
All right. By the way, have you seen Age of Ultron yet?
No, I have not. I was going to go see it today, but I got pulled away from doing other stuff.
Fuckity fuck fuck fuck.
I'll do my best to see it Thursday. I have Thursday off.
Okay, so do I, so...
And that'll give everyone, all of our listeners, to have some time so we can say, spoilers! And
yes.
Continue on our merry way.
All right.
Oh, it's also, I think it's made over $1 billion now. It's well close to it.
It's really goddamn close. In fact, I think that's one of my stories tonight.
Okay.
Let's see.
You want to go first or shall I?
Sure. Well, as that was our first story, here is the official... 875.3 million globally is Age of Ultron.
Oof.
So, yeah, that's a lot of money.
That is a lot of tacos.
Yes. Yes, it is.
I'm just wondering how long Marvel can keep this run going.
Well, they actually do have it planned to end eventually.
Really? I thought they were like going up to like 2020 or something.
Yeah, something like that. But the Avengers storyline as we know it is supposed to end.
Okay.
So, yeah.
It's ending probably with Infinity War.
Yeah.
Because Chris Evans already said when he's done with Captain America, he's done with acting. Whether that's true or not, you know.
We have yet to see it, of course.
Right. Right.
But yeah, have you heard about how Joss Whedon is throwing a hissy fit about how he still wants Coulson dead?
No, I hadn't heard that one.
Yeah, that one came in just today, actually.
Which is funny, considering he originally, when Avengers came out, he was the one that's screaming, I did not want to kill Coulson. The studio made me do that. I did not write that in script. Because he knew people were going to give him shit, because he's always killing characters people like.
Well, yeah. God damn it, see Age of Ultron!
Nah.
I can't make my point without you seeing it, damn it!
I'm sorry, I'm a bad nerd.
Alright, anyway. Meanwhile, on the DC front, Supergirl gets the green light for at CBS for the 2015-2016 season.
Yes, Supergirl got the green light, and Constantine got the axe.
Yep, but... Holy cow, does this Supergirl look awesome.
Yes, she do. I remember when I saw the first pictures of her. She looked quite nice.
Mm.
Now, speaking of Constantine, even though it has been canceled, they're trying desperately to figure out how to keep it going. Plus, Green, the guy who plays Arrow, really wants to do a Constantine-Arrow crossover.
That'd be pretty awesome.
Mm-hmm. So they're talking about they're possibly doing that, and they're also going to shop it to Netflix just in case. Whether it actually does or not, I probably... Probably one of those situations where I do eight episodes just to tie up the storyline.
It's still probably good probably good idea anyway.
Yeah. I never actually saw the show, though, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm. I saw the first season of Arrow, but beyond that...
Constantine.
Oh, Constantine? Nah, didn't watch it.
Yeah.
Which is probably why it's fucking canceled.
Exactly. No one watched it. Like, oh, Constantine's on. When is it on? Friday night? I'm normally working.
Yeah, exactly.
Or I'm doing something with friends, you know.
Right.
It's
your
not
turn.
Exactly the best evening. Okay. The truth is out there. X-Files debuts January 24th. The X-Files is a show with music by Mark Snow. The series was seen the return of Fox Mulder, Dan Scully, Walter Skinner, the cigarette-smoking man, and possibly the lone gunman. Even though four of those characters are dead...
My bad, nerd time. I've not actually watched all of the X-Files.
Okay, well, you know who the lone gunmen are, right?
Vaguely.
Okay, they had their own TV show for like one season.
Yeah, I have that on DVD.
Okay, I don't think, well, this is a spoilers, but it's been a, it's a 17-year-old, it's a 15-year-old spoiler, so I don't really care. they die. When their series ended, they ended up doing another guest shot on X-Files, and three of them die, saving a whole bunch of lives.
There you go.
And there's one of those where you saw the bodies, you saw everything there. It wasn't like a comic book movie, a comic book death, where it's like, no body, no death. No, you saw them die. Same thing with the cigarette-smoking man who died in the final episode. So how they're going to bring him back, I don't know. Still, still kind of torn about all this.
I want to believe,
but it's been 20 years, and
yeah,
it's sort of like how I feel if they tried to do Firefly now. I mean, it's been 13 years since the show was on. You can't go back and get the original cast. You're gonna have to recast it.
Yeah, plus they can't do Book anymore.
Why not? He's not dead.
Yeah, he is.
Oh, I'm sorry, the actor's not dead.
No, the actor's not dead, no, but the character is.
Well, Book and Wash are both dead. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm a leaf on the wind. You can just always tell when who's a Firefly fan by just whispering "I am a leaf on a wind" to them. And if they look at you confused, they're not a Firefly fan. If they look at you and go, "Why would you say that?" You know they saw Firefly.
Yeah, I actually was threatened with physical violence for saying that once. Yeah, I was there in art class, you know, sawing my project because you know we use saws and metals, and I just say, "I am a leaf on the wind. Watch me soar." And my friend across the way says, "I will fucking punch you. Never say that again." So, yeah.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, yeah, it's a great serial. But anyway, So, yeah, they're bringing back X-Files. It's going to be first of six new episodes. And from there on, doesn't really say how many they're going to be doing.
It looks like it's going to be an 8-episode miniseries.
Okay.
All right. Let's see.
The problem with the X-Files, it had the same problem with Lost did. It had all these meandering storylines that never went anywhere.
Again, I haven't watched Lost either.
Okay,
my dad,
but still.
My dad has watched it now, and yeah. All power to him, but I haven't.
Yeah.
This is one that I only kind of marginally care about because I watched all of the Yaesu Otaku episodes about it. But yep. There's going to be a 6-part movie series of Digimon to be released with a new cast.
Oh, okay. I saw something about that, and apparently they've redesigned some of the characters.
Yeah, something like that.
And unfortunately, there are some otaku who are just screaming that they're horrible and awful, and how dare you do this, blah, blah, blah. There are some people who are just way too passionate about things.
I understand that. Believe me, we're going to be talking tonight about Star Trek again. So,
yeah.
Believe me, I know this situation. But it's one of those situations of, be glad you're getting anything at all. I mean, your fandom's fucking dead. They're resurrecting it for you because there's enough of a fan base for it.
Yeah. Well, they had a lot of lens flare. Shut up.
Exactly. I mean, there's this... There's this series called Nightmare Cafe, which is brilliant. It only had like 6 episodes.
I remember that show. It was very vaguely based around Nightmare on Elm Street.
Exactly. But I don't know of anybody else other than now you who has ever even heard of it.
Yep, I watched a couple episodes. It was really nice. It was like you said, 6 or 7 episodes though.
Yeah, I've watched all the episodes. Again, brilliant. But. Yeah. There's not enough of a fan base for it, so it's never going to see the light of day again.
Mm-hmm. Darn it. Okay, anyway, let's continue with our news. Okay.
Yeah.
Your turn.
I I was the one with the Digimon one.
Oh, Digimon. I'm sorry. I was still stuck on X-Files. Mutants no longer. Scarlet Witch and Quicksilver get huge history retcons. Apparently because Marvel is having way too much fun fucking over everybody else. They've killed off the Fantastic Four in the comics, so there can't be any cross-pollination between them and the new Fantastic Four movie.
Mm-hmm.
They have messed with the X-Men in the comics, so the X-Men movies have issues. And now they're saying, because they are not allowed legally to use the word mutants in their movies,
mm-hmm.
they are retconning Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch, who have always been mutants, and they were the children of
Magneto,
instead to say that it is the Ultra, what's his name? God damn it. A High Evolutionary, sorry.
Oh, is this in the comics?
Yes, this is in the comics.
Oh, okay.
They're in the comics. They're now saying that they're not actually the children of Magneto. They were failed experiments by the High Evolutionary.
I can't say anything on this story because of Age of Ultron. Fucking see the movie, all right?
Okay, I'm sorry.
When you see the movie, then we can talk.
Okay. Please hold your thoughts till next Monday.
I will.
Okay. Oh my god.
Meanwhile, in the realm of why the fuck do we need this? And things where I immediately needed brain bleach after experiencing. The full Human Centipede 3 trailer is
been released. I saw it.
So did I.
Eric Roberts, do you really need a paycheck that badly? I mean, I know you were going to be Marty McFly, but you've done a lot of parts that are not you cannot be proud of. I mean, he was in Sharktopus, but do you really need to be in a Human Centipede movie?
It's just
Tiny Lister is in this movie. He's a legitimately good actor. He's been in big movies. He was in Fifth Element. He was the president of the world. He should not be in the Human Centipede movies.
At this point, though, it's one of those situations of the first one, urban legend. Nobody hears of this movie. Second one, oh, hey, they did it again. Third one, okay, now they're going for the big guns and all of that. So it's one of those situations of who doesn't want to be in this movie? Some people. Or at least that's what I assume.
Yeah.
But still, it's fucking stupid.
I've never wanted to see the movie. I've never interested in seeing the movies. I'm never going to see any of the movies. It's just blah, blah, blah.
I might watch them at some point, but on my own terms.
I'd rather watch the cinema snob make fun of it.
Alright. Go for it. Your turn.
Let's see here. Let's have some happy news, shall we?
Okay.
Brad Bird confirms Incredibles sequel his next film.
Woohoo!
Tomorrowland director has previously revealed he's been writing a script for a second Incredibles movie, and in an interview with Collider, he puts the long-discussed on schedule as his next film. Oh yeah, I have pages, a bunch of pages. I have a lot of ideas from the original Incredibles that I get a chance to use that I like. I have ideas that I wanted to pursue a little bit, and there wasn't enough time in Incredibles. These are new ideas I have, and I think there are enough of those to make an interesting movie. And I'm just focusing on getting Tomorrowland out and then playing with the Incredibles sandbox again. See, Incredibles is one of those movies that should have had a sequel a long time ago.
Exactly. It needed to happen like fucking yesterday.
Yes. Because it's one of the best comic movies ever. Even if the comic book never existed.
Exactly.
Even if it's basically a retelling of Watchmen. But
it's a kid-friendly Watchmen. I mean, give some credit to that.
Yeah, it is. It's just a fantastic movie, and I love it, and I can't wait to see what Brad Bird does with it.
I know, right? I'm stoked. I'm in. I want 5. Yeah. Alright. Some more happy news.
Okay.
The Oculus Rift virtual reality headset is officially coming out next year.
I forgot to tell you. Go ahead with your story.
Oh, it was announced on May 6th. And, yeah, It's raised over $2 million, and well, it raised over $2 million back in 2012. So right. Yeah, it looks like
then
it's all ready to go.
By Facebook for like $2 billion. Yeah.
Yep.
Forgot to tell you, I'm in possession of Oculus Rift.
The fuck?
Anyway, no, my roommate has a buddy who was given an Oculus Rift developer's kit for Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
And just has no time to use it, so he gave it to us to use as long as we want to.
Sweet.
And we haven't had time to set it up yet, but I will very soon.
Awesome.
And I've already got a couple games that I know I own on my computer that use the Oculus Rift, so I'm going to pop it in as soon as I can.
Cool. I have some more Joss Whedon news, actually.
Okay.
So you remember how Joss Whedon recently stormed off Twitter?
Yeah.
Yeah, he has gone on to say that it was not because of militant feminists.
Right, it was basically because he's got a lot of work he's got to do and Twitter eats up a lot of his time.
Exactly.
It's sort of like he basically goes into self-exile from the internet, which makes perfect sense to me.
Yep. Sounds perfectly justifiable to me.
Yep. All right, here we go. Claire Temple, Rosario Dawson's character in Daredevil, will be returning in season 2. And will also be appearing in the other Netflix Defenders series.
Yes!
So she will be a common thread between the four series. Because, you know, Night Nurse is a valid Marvel character and has appeared in a number of the comics.
Mm-hmm.
So, yay! Plus it's Rosario Dawson and she's awesome.
Oh, yeah. More on Marvel, because I have a lot of Marvel news this week.
Okay.
Infinity War is going to be the first movie in history to be filmed entirely using IMAX digital cameras.
Nice.
There's no actual film to it. It's completely digital.
Hmm.
So, yeah.
That'll be pretty.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very pretty. Let's see here. I'm just going to get this one out of the way.
Go for it.
Marlon Wayans working on 50 Shades of Grey parody movie.
Okay.
Yeah, pretty much my reaction. But I'm like, eh, why not? Anything that makes fun of parody of 50 Shades of Grey is okay in my book.
I still can't believe they're making a fucking sequel.
Well, I knew they were going to make a sequel because the first movie made money. It just depends on whether the second movie's going to make money. Because there's been a lot of times where the first movie comes out and it's huge and the sequel comes out and it tanks.
So, yeah.
I'm still hoping that's going to happen.
Me too.
Lord, I'm hoping that happens.
I don't think I've ever I don't think I've ever begged for something to fail so hard before, other than Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
It's just wrong on every single level. Ugh.
Like I said before, I tried reading a page once, and I nearly threw it against the wall. I mean, the writing is just so atrocious. I don't get why it's so popular.
Me either, man.
All right. Anyway, your turn.
Nintendo partners with Universal theme parks for rides and attractions. So you remember how the Marvel stuff is going out of Universal?
Yeah, we were talking about that. There's a rumor that they're leaving, and this I was actually thinking about this too. Mm-hmm. I know exactly what you're going to say.
But yeah, looks like they've got something that's coming in. So it's Nintendo.
So hopefully, now I do hope that some of the Marvel rides are at least moved over to Disney or reimagined, because the Spider-Man ride is really a lot of fun.
Yeah, that'd be pretty rad. To be totally honest, I've really never been to either theme park. Sorry, I just haven't. There's a lot that's of fun. I haven't yet.
Well, you're only 20 years old. You still got time.
Yeah.
Just don't put it off forever.
Right. So, yeah, there's that.
Okay. Here's one for our science nerd friends. Our real science.
Go for it.
NASA may have accidentally discovered faster-than-light travel.
By accident? That's my favorite kind of way.
A team at NASA may have unintentionally accelerated particles to faster-than-light speeds while using the M-drive resonance chamber. Basically, if the findings turn out to be accurate, the team may have discovered faster-than-light travel. To clarify, the M-drive resonance chamber is a proposed method of interstellar propulsion. Basically, this would end up being the engines that the starship of the future use. The advantages of using such a device are numerous. It's electrically powered, it features no moving parts, and it doesn't require any material fuel to move. If it ends up working as planned, there's a good chance it could lead to a new breed of engine. Basically, what it creates is a warp bubble. It creates a warp bubble and pushes faster than the speed of light while a solid object behind it is pulled along as if it was moving at normal speed.
Oh my god.
Yes. It's basically what the Enterprise works.
Okay, yeah. That just makes me so happy.
Yeah. So, literally, it's probably not going to be within our lifetime, but it is a severe possibility within 100 years or so we could have faster than light speed.
Sweet. Meanwhile, back on Earth, still some Marvel. Actually, I think I only have 3 stories left that are not Marvel.
Okay.
So, yeah. Marvel Studios has begun production on Captain America: Civil War.
Mm-hmm.
And it released the official cast list not too long ago. Or at least
Martin Freeman.
Yes, Martin Freeman is in the movie. We don't know who. Or as who, but he's in there.
Yay.
So, yeah, there you go.
Cool. Let's see. No, that's for my things that should not be. Fully functioning Tron light cycle sold for $77,000.
Okay, that was actually one of them.
Okay. Yeah, the electric neon flashing motorcycle from 2010's Tron Legacy has escaped the digital realm thanks to this insanely accurate and functional custom bike, built bike. It doesn't say how fast it goes, though.
That's too bad.
Oh, well. It's going to be fun to, like, you know, drive down the road with a thing and make people crash going, holy shit.
Well, hey, you can always do that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, cool. So, you remember how we do have those awesome X-Men movies coming out?
Yeah, like Days of Future Past, not Days of Future Past, Apocalypse and Wolverine 3.
Mm-hmm.
Which is going to be the last movie Hugh Jackman makes. Or the last Wolverine movie that Hugh Jackman makes, sorry.
Well, on Apocalypse, we have a fatality.
Oh, no.
James McAvoy's beautiful, long, flowing hair is now gone to become the most iconic Professor Xavier.
Oh, for God's sakes. You had me all worried there. Sound like, you know, when Jared Leto cut his hair when he was becoming the Joker, and it was like, and BuzzFeed's like, oh, let us have an epitaph
let with us
long, luscious locks. I'm like, shut up.
Yeah, but in this case, it's one of those situations of something in that movie just died. And
it
was on
Jane sooner or later.
Yeah, but it was on James McAvoy's head, though.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
As long as it's not on William Shatner's head, then it's like a dead beat, like a dead badger or something.
So, yeah, we officially have the exposed cue ball of Professor Xavier.
Man, it had to happen sooner or later.
Yep.
And now Patrick Stewart can look at join James McAvoy. You are like me now, boy.
Well, it's been fun having his hair anyway.
Yep. All right, let's see. In the art world, Picasso painting sells for a record $179 million.
Yeah, I saw something about that. I didn't add it to the geek news, but please, do enlighten.
The 1955 canvas, La Femmes d'Alger, otherwise known as the Women of Algeria, so it's a new bar for the contemporary art field. Previously, the most expensive art sold at a auction was Francis Bacon's 3 Studies of Lucian Freud, which went for $142 million in 2013.
Wow.
The last time this particular painting sold was in 1997 for $31.9 million. Now, I've seen the post. I'm not a huge fan of, like, cubism.
Mm-hmm.
So I just never really got Picasso.
Fair enough.
Apparently, I don't have enough money to be snooty.
Well, you just don't understand the quality of his brush strokes and the use of his
primary colors. And
because I went to collage.
Oh, I went to collage with Oxford. You know, whatever. Yeah. I'm like, what the hell. You know, I do love myself some Salvador Dali. Dali was a fantastic painter.
Yeah,
very
freaking
awesome
love Dali.
Surreal stuff. So, yay! Okay.
All right. Well, that actually wrapped it up for my Marvel stuff.
Okay. We got one more piece?
I actually have just two left.
Okay, go ahead and you run your two, and I will do the my thing that should not be.
All right. First of all, you remember Castlevania?
Yeah.
There is a successor coming out called Bloodstained: Ritual of the Night.
Ooh.
And it's on Kickstarter, and it's raised quite a bit of money already.
Nice.
So, yeah. Let's see.
Is it going to be a 2D platformer? Or have they said that was going to be yet?
There's not much detail here yet, so.
Okay.
I'll try to keep my eye on it. And, actually, I have one of those shits that should not be.
Okay.
May 9th, officially recognized as Goku Day in Japan. Yes, because Dragon Ball Z needed to be celebrated that much.
Is there any particular reason for the, is there some significance to the date?
I don't know.
Okay.
The numbers 5 and 9 can be read in Japanese as Go and Ku, respectively, so...
That's probably the reason, then.
Fair enough. Whatever. So, yeah, Dragon Ball Z now has an official date for celebration. Good job.
Yay. Okay. Are you ready for this one?
Oh, shit.
We are in the wrong business, my friend.
Uh-oh.
This man earns almost 700 pounds a month writing hardcore porn about the Apple Watch and Tetris.
What?
The writer of a porn novel about the Apple Watch has claimed his bizarre erotic stories net him about $1,000 a month, or 650 pounds. Leonard Delaney has published a string of bizarre pornographic short stories with titles like Invaded by the iWatch, Taken by the Tetris Blocks, and Conquered by Clippy, which depicts a torrid affair with Microsoft Office's virtual assistant.
Whoa. Okay, now all I have in my head is slash fix between Yar from Yar's Revenge and Pitfall Harry from Pitfall. Because I never wanted an image of a mutant housefly being fucked up the ass. What has this show done to me?
God knows. So are these books any good? Books, editor for the Mirrors, editor for the Daily Mirror said that it's short, about 4,000 words, the kind of thing you can knock out in an afternoon. And stylistically, it's drawing on the slash fiction for comedy with tones of American Psycho, with the consumer brand fetish and laid on quick. Is it satire of a type? More than anything, it's commercial comedic writing. The key thing to these books is there's no budget to promote them, so the author needs to think of a title that makes a potential reader think, what on the earth is this? We live in exciting times, really. The rebirth of both Pulp Fiction and the short story. We're in the wrong job, man.
Clearly. We clearly need to just knock out this podcast stuff and just, you know, publish short stories and pulpy blech, stuff.
Yeah. I'm sure we can come with some horrible things real quickly, you know.
Well, you know, that is what we do with Thou Shalt Not anyway, so...
Yeah, yeah. Thou shalt not write pornography involving Pepsi Man.
Oh, fuck. All right. Well,
thou shalt not write an action thriller with the Burger King.
Slash flick. Okay, now that sounds like a porno film type of deal that's really low budget.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Watch as Buzz the Honeybee is violated by Lucky, the leprechaun.
You were always after me, Lucky Charms. Sorry.
Well, after that lovely scarring, I think we should go on to
Star
the
Trek
Final Frontier.
Part 2. Yes, Star Trek Part 2. Part 2. We're lost, lovely heroes.
Yeah, so last time we left off, we were there with Generations. So Kirk and Spock have, Kirk and Spock have, you know, finally flown their last, and Picard meets Kirk for the first and last time in a movie that makes no goddamn sense.
Well, what was really sad was when they were filming the beginning of that film with Kirk, they couldn't even get Leonard Nimoy and DeForest Kelly to come back.
Yeah.
Because apparently they were so sick of William Shatner's bullshit. So they got Walter Koenig and James Doohan to come back instead. And the idea is that they're flying this ship out, and then somehow Kirk gets swallowed by a wormhole or something.
Yeah, it's something called the Nexus.
The Nexus, along with the Malcolm McDowell playing a completely useless bad guy.
Dr. Soren.
Dr. Soren.
Now, every single time... Now, I watched all of the Nostalgia Critic episodes of the Trek month.
Mm-hmm.
Every time he made a Sauron joke, it pissed me off! It's Sorin, not Sauron.
Sorin, you stupid bitch! Sorin!
Sorin!
We must take the ring to Sorin. And you just bunch and bow, blow into the Nostalgia Critic's office. It's Sorin, you asshole! And you start beating him with, you know, start hitting him with a salami or something.
Oh! Ooh! Ooh, that's one. A little too Freddy Got Fingered for me, thanks.
Okay, a ham the size of a baby.
I can do that.
There you go. So Generations comes out, not a big success.
No.
But it makes its money back.
Yep. And then in...
and it also had some absolutely most useless things they've ever done for the Next Generation.
Yeah.
They kill off Picard's family.
Yep.
For no reason, just to give, apparently to give Jean-Luc Picard, a.k.a. Patrick Stewart, a moment to act. And they crashed the damn ship.
I thought the crashing the ship was fine. I mean, really, I'm surprised it didn't happen earlier.
Ugh.
Besides, I like the Enterprise E better. It's sexy.
Oh, the Enterprise E is gorgeous. I wish I still had it. I actually had an ornament. Holiday ornament for the Enterprise E. I had a whole shitload of Hallmark ornaments for Star Trek, and they were actually worth a lot of money until my roommate's dog ate them.
Oh no!
Yeah,
The Wonder Husky that ate them?
Yep, Kiko the Wonder Husky took big chomps out of. So I can't have a Christmas tree in my house because she eats the ornaments. Yeah, I still have the most expensive one though. It's Star Trek Galileo. That one never left its box. I can't really say much because I didn't pay a lot of money for him. I got him at a garage sale in the boxes for like $1 a piece.
Fair enough.
Dude did not know what he had, so I'm like, okay. And I used a bunch of those to give him as gifts for Christmas that year.
Not bad.
But the Galileo, if it's got the lights and sound, it's worth about $75.
Jesus.
Yeah, so it's staying in the box.
Fair enough.
The dog is not getting a chance to get to it. Yeah, Generations, not such a great movie. I'm sorry.
But then, in 95, we get Star Trek Voyager.
Yep, Voyager.
With Kate Mulgrew and Tim Russ and a host of others.
Kate Mulgrew was actually the second choice for Captain Janeway.
Who was the first?
Adrian Barbeau, if I'm not mistaken.
I think I remember hearing that somewhere along the lines.
Hold on, let me find out. I'm hoping I spell this right. She originally was cast, and just the character did not work out, or the actress did not work out.
Interesting.
Yeah, here we go. Hold on, I'll look up Wikipedia. They got like half a day of shooting, and, hold on. Start. Maybe it wasn't Adrian Barbeau. Hold on. No. It doesn't really matter. Basically, another actress was all set to play the part. Star Trek Janeway. And she did not work out. She was going to be the new one, and...
It never worked out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Genevieve Bajol. That was the name.
Okay.
Canadian actress best known for her portrayal of Anne Boleyn in the 1969 film Anne of the Thousand Days, which she won a Golden Globe Award. And apparently she was chosen... She cited the lengthy work schedule for TV series and her unwillingness to do news interviews.
Mm-hmm.
But apparently, from what I've read in other places, she didn't like the idea of doing science fiction. She thought it was very silly.
Hmm.
She just was not a science fiction person. So they basically grabbed Kate Mulgrew and went, "Hey, you want a job?" And she's like, "Okay."
Yep. Hey, that's fair enough.
Yep.
In 1998, this is a place where I've actually been a couple times. Star Trek The Experience opened in Las Vegas.
Yeah, I wish I'd been a chance to get to see that.
Yep, I went twice.
Mm.
And it was awesome. It had to shut down not too long ago so that it could be, repaired and all that, because it was continuously running.
Mm.
But, yeah.
Is it going to reopen again?
There are always stirrings and whispers about it reopening. I don't know if it has or not yet. In fact, I should probably look. Star Trek The Experience.
I do remember there was a Star Trek exhibit at King's Island down in Cincinnati.
Mm-hmm.
Years ago, I went and saw that, and it was like, they had people walking around dressed as, it was during the DS9 episodes. I think it was probably around 92 or 93, if I had to guess. Because I remember there was a Bajoran and a Klingon, and they just had a bunch of, like, you know, the props and such from the films and the movies, the props and the TV shows. And it was cool. But at one point, there were like, I think there were actually two or... Are you sure that there... I could have sworn there was like three... At one point, they had Next Generation, DS9, and Voyager all at the same time.
Next Generation had ended by the time that Deep Space Nine had...
Started?
No.
By the time Next Generation did.
Next Generation had ended by the time Voyager had started.
Okay. All right.
So, Next Generation might have been there in reruns, but it wasn't still going.
Okay, because I remember DS9 was on, and they had the Dominion War, which was actually pretty cool.
Oh, yeah. If you ever want to see the Federation at War, yeah.
Yeah.
Totally watch the last,
seasons.
Last three seasons.
Yeah.
Plus, season 5 has that great episode, Trials and Tribulations.
Yes.
Where they go back in time and deal with the Tribbles all over again.
And they cut it with the original Trouble with Tribbles.
And it's so well integrated, too.
Oh, God, yes. Especially Worf's comment. Like, are those Klingons? Yes. What happened? It was a dark time for our people. We don't speak of it. So you never exactly find out what happened.
I know, right? Although they did explain it in Enterprise.
Oh, they did?
Yeah.
It's like a virus or something?
Yeah, the Klingons were all dying off of a virus. So what they had to do was, in a moment of great desperation... They had to briefly mix some of their DNA with human DNA, so that's how they lost their forehead ridges.
Okay, makes sense. And apparently they got it back, because the same actors played the same roles in Next Generation with forehead ridges.
There you go. And they also came back in Deep Space Nine, too.
Yep. Now, I do remember that one episode of DS9, where Dominion launched an all-out war. Was it the Klingons launched an all-out war on the space station. And they discovered just how heavily armed they were.
I'm trying to remember when that would have been.
It was when Galron had been taken over by a changeling.
Right.
And he turned
the
Klingon Empire against the Federation.
Mm,
and then they figured out Galron was actually being held prisoner. They rescued him. He comes back and basically tells the Klingon Empire, "You've been tricked. We're going to war against the Dominion again with our Federation brothers." And the Klingons went, "Fuck and yes,
yes."
the Federation has honor.
Fair enough, man. Fair enough.
Yeah, and then the only thing I didn't like about the end, it had that stupid ending. I call it the Quantum Leap ending,
mm-hmm.
where Benjamin Sisko gets dragged in by the Founders, the ones in the wormhole.
Mm-hmm.
And disappears and never comes back.
Yep.
And it's Quantum Leap had the same problem. I don't know if you are familiar with the show at all. Quantum Leap?
Of course.
Yeah. Okay. Did you ever see the final episode?
No, actually, I've only seen the first season all the way through.
But you're familiar with the concept. He's
Absolutely.
Sam Beckett is trying to get home. He keeps jumping from body to body to basically save people and change lives and change the things around.
Right.
And at the final episode, he ends up in essentially what's kind of like heaven, but it's a weird heaven. And people and other characters he's interacted with over time are there, but as different roles. And he recognizes them from when he first saw them in the other lives he jumped into. And he recognized how much good he has done, how much people he has saved.
Mm-hmm.
And he decides to continue to jump around a little bit more, to help as many people as he can. But at the end, it says, Samuel Beckett never made it home. And I'm like, you fuckers.
Well, yeah, but at the same time, if Samuel Beckett never made it home, it's probably because doing the jump arounds on all that, he kind of null and voided his timeline anyway.
Well, but also he left his wife, his wife, he didn't remember he had a wife, and she's waiting for him.
Yeah, but still, it's kind of hard to do he returned home when suddenly the entire past that he's changed has directly influenced the future in one way or another.
Yeah, but however, there was one good thing, he was allowed by God, he actually met God.
Oh, good.
Who essentially, it's hinted that it's God. And it's hinted that this is the person that's been responsible for him jumping all during all these lives. He's given a chance to go change one thing. He's allowed to change absolutely just one thing for his own selfish needs.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes back and he explains to Al's wife,
mm-hmm.
who had left him because she thought Al was dead in Vietnam.
Right.
He goes back and tells her that he's still alive and he's coming back. So that changes that portion of the timeline. Al is, instead of being a philanderer who's a bit of a jerk, they celebrate a 30th wedding anniversary or something.
Right. I remember.
So, yeah, that was cool. That was a good ending. But still, I just wanted to get home, man. Just like, I just want Cisco to get home. Well, during this time period is when a lot of the fans started getting a little more annoyed with Rick Berman and Brandon Braga.
Yep.
Who were the producers on Star Trek.
Because by this point, Gene Roddenberry was very, very dead.
Yes, he was an ex-Roddenberry. He's pining for the fjords. No, he is an ex. He has passed on. He is an ex-Roddenberry.
He has ceased to be, bereft in life. He rests in peace. If you had nailed him to the perch, you would be pushing up the daisies. He has run down the mortal coil and gone to meet Mr. Chapman.
Anyway. But no, anyway. Rick Berman and Brandon Braga wanted to have a lot more conflict. They wanted to have more darkness. They didn't want to show that the future was all bright and happy like Roddenberry had done for so long. And a lot of fans started to see that they started to think this was making the show suffer.
I don't know. I still think Deep Space Nine has still some of the most poignant episodes of the whole series in general.
Oh, it does. It does.
Plus, there are just some darn memorable ones.
Oh, yeah. I love the episode where Jake and Captain Commander Sisko travel in a solar sailor, and they basically rewrite history by accident.
Yeah, or let's see, the Take Me Out to the Holosuite where they all play baseball.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Like, they're in the middle of a fucking war, and suddenly you've got some Romulan jackass. No, it's Vulcan. He's a Vulcan jackass. He comes in and he's just like, yeah, I have a program on my Holosuite. You might be interested in it. It's baseball. I mean, it's seriously, that's just one of those, you come to my house, and you put that on my table. You do not put that on my table.
So let's see. We got that. Then we got Voyager.
Yes.
Voyager, I never knew what to make of Voyager.
It's Gilligan's Island in space.
Yeah, but not nearly as fun.
To be reductive.
Yeah. A 5-year tour, a 5-year tour. And I'm sorry, I never much cared for Janeway. Not because she's a woman. That's not the problem. I just never... Her voice and her attitude always kind of grated on me.
I don't know. I'm personally fine with it. I like the way it intermingles, even though they're very, very far apart between Deep Space Nine and Voyager. Mm-hmm. I like Kate Mulgrew as Janeway. I think she's fine. Seven of Nine is a great character who's introduced later.
Yeah. She was the TNA character. Another problem is I had a lot of the characters in Voyager were just kind of bland. I mean, Tom Paris was okay, but Harry Kim was bland. Chakotay was bland.
With a side of bland.
Tuvok was bland.
Oh, he's also Vulcan, so I think we can give him a pass on that one.
Yeah, even, what's her name? Half-human, half-Klingon. You can see her. Yeah, she's bland, too. She's just, I'm the angry young woman. Rawr.
Eh. I think the show's fine.
And, Neelix was, he was cute. I mean, he's interesting.
Yeah, I like Neelix.
And Nick, what's her name? Kix or,
Kes.
Kes. Kes is just, she was a cute little alien, I guess.
Yeah, Kes
didn't really serve a lot of purpose.
Yeah.
She was the TNA, the original TNA, and when they introduced Seven of Nine, they didn't need any more TNA from her.
And so Seven of Nine brought the show into a whole different other area that really explored the Borg more than we ever really had, which brings us into 1996 when Star Trek First Contact is released.
Yes, yes.
Now, this is the first Star Trek movie that comes out after my birth.
Right. Never seen it in the theaters, and I actually quite enjoyed it. It was the first one I'd seen since Undiscovered Country I'd seen in the theaters, which is, you know, Generations was the only other one. And I liked it.
Yeah. It was really good.
Well done. It's very well done. Well written. Well directed. Good story. I mean, it's a time travel story, which I've never been a huge fan of. But, yeah, they did it in a valid way.
And it involved the Borg. I mean, how do you do the Borg in a movie? Well, clearly this movie did it.
And Alice Krieger did a fantastic job as the Borg Queen.
Hmm.
And then there was this... you ever look at an actor and you think that they should be a star? And you don't understand why they're not?
Yeah.
There's an actor in First Contact. His name's Neil McDonoghue. And he's a German actor.
Mm-hmm.
But he's got such a striking face and striking eyes, and he's a very good actor. I never understood why he wasn't bigger. I mean, actually, after the First Contact came out, he was really considering quitting acting until someone offered him a couple more roles, and he, still out there doing his thing. But he's like, you know, one of those guaranteed performance guys.
There you go.
But I just remember seeing him in First Contact. I'm like, he looks so familiar. And it's not because he's familiar. He just looks like a freaking movie star.
Yeah.
He looks like he should be huge.
Mm-hmm.
And, Data had a good job. Did pretty well. This is before they put the emotion chip into Data, which was one of the dumbest things ever.
Actually, no. They did the emotion chip in Generations.
Oh, okay. I hated that thing.
To be totally honest, I feel like Data is a performance that kind of wears thin very quickly.
Yeah.
Because you can only do "What does it mean to be man?" so many times before it's just one of those, you establish that like five other episodes before. Stop it!
Yeah.
I can't take it anymore!
I don't understand! Get away from me! But yeah.
Yeah.
But then, First Contact came out, really good movie.
Mm-hmm.
Love James Cromwell. Love the fact that he has to fly out on Born to be Wild?
Yes. No, it was Magic Carpet Ride.
Magic Carpet Ride. Okay, Steppenwolf. I remember that much.
Mm-hmm.
Steppenwolf, and it was funny. And this is before, before Thomas Riker started getting large.
Yeah.
He started gaining some weight. Don't get me wrong, I love Jonathan Frakes, but he's let himself go a bit.
It's William Riker. Thomas Riker is the evil clone.
Okay, I meant William Frakes, the actor.
Jonathan Frakes is the actor.
Fuck you! I don't care anymore. Screw you
Get
and
it
your
straight.
Nerd cred. Screw you and your nerd cred.
I did research on this back when I was in sixth grade.
Okay, but no. And then there's Patrick Stewart, who never fucking changes.
Exactly. He just does not age. He does not.
He's timeless, and he's never had hair. No, I'm
it's
serious.
True.
I remember I was watching the 1970s PBS version of I, Claudius, and he's in there. because he was a well-respected Shakespearean actor at the time, and he had no damn hair. Now, granted, back then it actually had color, but still, what he had...
Right.
It was like, the man must have started going bald when he was like 12.
21, actually.
Poor guy. Yeah. That's, you've researched that, too?
No, he just mentioned that on Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me.
Oh, okay.
So but that was one of those, I learned in passing.
Okay. But yes, First Contact, huge success. And then what was the next one? Nemesis?
No, Insurrection.
Insurrection.
Okay. Now, I love my Star Trek soundtracks and scores and all that.
Right.
Insurrection is a useless score for a useless movie.
Remind me again exactly which Insurrection is. I'm trying to remember. Nemesis is the one with the Patrick, with the Jean-Luc Picard clone.
Mm-hmm.
Is Insurrection the one where they have to save another planet that's filled with people who don't die, who never get old?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's the one.
All right. Yeah, I was kind of bored with that movie.
No, it's literally useless. It serves no purpose. It's not a good movie.
Hmm.
And it confounds everything else because in the middle, when that movie is taking place, the Federation is at war and losing badly. I mean...
Is that when the Dominion War is going on?
Yeah.
So there's no reason why the Enterprise E, which is like the freaking flagship,
should not be
out there busting ass.
Exactly. It's like a Deus Ex Machina on warp nacelles. It should be there, but it's not.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Insurrection. Useless movie. Useless score for useless movie.
And then we have Nemesis.
Yes.
And that pretty much killed the franchise.
Yep. But
it came out... I never saw it, unfortunately.
It's not that bad, though.
Wasn't it James McAvoy as the...
Wouldn't that be interesting? Let me look. Let's see.
I'm remembering that there had some... The actor was, like, really well... Is, like, someone who's, like, famous now. Played John Picard's, clone.
Yes.
And
Shinzon is his name, by the way.
Okay, I'm gonna let all of our 12 listeners know, I know nothing about Enterprise. I literally have seen an episode of Enterprise.
Oh, God. I found out who it is.
Okay.
It's Tom Hardy.
Hello, I am the clone of Jean-Luc Picard.
Yes, and you're still not scary. I don't know, he was... Alright. I'll give. He was scary. He was actually pretty good in this movie. The movie is just convoluted. Certain things happen that just shouldn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
It meanders a bit. I mean, it's still enjoyable, kind of. It's not the weak link that everybody makes it out to be. It just killed the franchise.
Right. The only reason they're weak link is because it just didn't make any money.
Yeah.
And then you had Enterprise, which just was not making much in the way of ratings.
Yeah, Enterprise takes place 100 years before Kirk's time.
Didn't James Cromwell actually show up as
as Zefram Cochrane, yeah.
Yeah, he actually showed up in one episode.
Yep, he shows up in the very beginning. Kind of a send-off from the previous series.
Okay.
So, yeah, I watched a bunch of it while it was actually on the air.
Okay.
It's kind of forgettable.
Mm.
Like, you were complaining how Voyager had bland characters with a side of bland.
Right.
This is a 3-course meal of bland characters.
Ooh.
I can't for the life of me remember anything really concrete about any of the human characters. At all.
They're that bland. Yeah.
The ship design is really cool. It's the first series where no actual models were used.
Mm-hmm. It's all digital.
It's all digital, but it's not that interesting.
Now, I will say one thing about Voyager.
Mm-hmm.
I liked the fact that they were able to bring Barclay into it.
Yes.
Played by the great Dwight Schultz.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's actually a really fun character. I really liked him on the original Star Trek Next Generation.
Mm-hmm. And he actually has a cameo in First Contact, too.
Yeah, he does.
But yeah.
And then they...
Go ahead.
I can't remember.
Oh, God.
But no, I just thought it was really good. And then they had the guy, the doctor was modeled off of. They had him there.
Mm-hmm.
And then the final episode, I actually never saw the final episode of Voyager. I heard it was okay, though.
I liked it.
It was weird, because they basically did a time travel thing, and they kind of negated the entire trip. Or they negated a portion of it.
Kind of. Basically, what happens is, Janeway from the future decides that she doesn't like the way things have gone, so she travels, 3 years before Voyager would have made its return anyway, and basically makes a deal with the Borg Queen to basically give Voyager free travel through one of their portals to the Alpha sector.
Right, because someone died. I remember that happened.
Yeah.
Like one of the crew had passed away, and she felt that it was completely unnecessary. So the Federation was chasing her because she was trying to change the timeline,
mm-hmm.
and which is kind of odd.
Yep. It's a good episode though. I recommend it.
And then Enterprise ended with completely unnecessary cameos by Deanna Troi and William Riker.
Yeah, back on the D. On the Enterprise D.
But I just want to say, how awesome was the final episode of Next Generation?
Oh, that was awesome.
Q is a great character, and they used him so perfectly.
Oh yeah, he's the linchpin to the entire story. So it's a damn good thing that they do have him as the final puzzle of the series.
Yeah. So anyway, Enterprise. Yes. Enterprise in 2005. Ends the glorious almost 20-year reign of Star Trek on television.
Yep.
And then in 2009?
Yeah, 2009.
Is when J.J. Abrams is given the reins.
Yep.
Well, technically 2008. But he gets on there and he makes a big-budget Star Trek movie.
Yeah.
Which completely rewrites the timeline again. Because time travel.
Except in this... In this case, it's one of those situations of, we're going back to Kirk and Spock when they were really, really young.
Which is really kind of annoying, because that's exactly one of the storylines that Gene Roddenberry actually wanted to do. He kept wanting to do Kirk and Spock in the Starfleet Academy. He wanted to base an entire series around that.
Problem is, though, everybody's tried their hand at that one by now.
Yeah.
Literally everyone. Like, I have comics from back in the 70s where... They've tried that one. It's...
Of course, the other thing that Gene Roddenberry wanted to do was go back and try to prevent the JFK assassination.
Right.
Because apparently the storyline he wrote was Spock had decided this was when human evolution or human society started going down because they killed JFK. Therefore, he was going to go back in time and stop the murders, and so Kirk and the crew had to go stop Spock. I think Roddenberry was losing it by the end of his life. How about you?
Yeah, I think so.
But anyway, so you've got Star Trek, the next new Star Trek, with Chris Pine as Kirk.
Mm-hmm. Zachary Quinto as Spock, and Leonard Nimoy is also his regular Spock self.
Regular Spock self, with Winona Ryder playing Spock's mom.
Mm-hmm.
And what's his name? Carl Urban.
Yes.
Playing a tremendously good, basically channeling DeForest Kelly.
Exactly, with McCoy.
As Dr. McCoy.
Yeah.
Simon Pegg as Scotty.
And that's just brilliant.
It was brilliant, but the movie was, it was fun, but it had some really bizarre situations.
Okay. Like,
they invented on-the-fly teleportation.
It's kind of explained away as this is something that Scotty from Spock Prime's timeline was kind of toying with.
Mm-hmm. But so now they've done it, so basically they can transport anywhere at any time.
Yeah.
And I'm like, this is a really major, huge deal, and they used it once.
Maybe he just didn't catch everything with the one glance that he actually took.
Yeah, maybe he's like, oh, I got it to work once.
Exactly. I think it's fine.
All right. That was just one of the big ones. But Eric Bana did a very, very good job as an evil Romulan.
Yes.
Technically, I don't. He was one of those. So much. He wouldn't start out as evil. He was just driven to evil.
Yeah. It's basically, I am angry, so I'm going to fuck shit up.
Yeah. And I do like the fact that every time we see Chris Pine as Kirk, never won a battle in that entire goddamn thing.
Pretty much.
Unlike the original Kirk, he kept getting his ass whooped.
Different circumstances, man. Yeah, he had no dad.
He had no dad, man. He had no dad.
Well, yeah. You know what?
Played by Chris Hemsworth. Yep.
So basically,
if your dad had been Thor, Captain Kirk would have been much tougher.
Exactly. Which is why Shatner's Kirk is so much tougher, clearly.
Yes, because his dad was Thor.
And why that stupid cupped hand to the back always works. That's clearly got to be the answer, because his dad was Thor.
Right, right. Let's see. They did have a very hot Orion girl in there.
Mm-hmm.
Something about girls with green skin. Oof. Anyway, and then they had...
You're not wrong.
No. And unfortunately, I didn't see Into the Darkness.
I did see Into Darkness. I actually saw it, I think, opening night.
Okay.
I liked it.
I know Benedict Cumberbatch is actually is Noon Singh.
Yeah, he is Khan.
And a lot of people gave shit for that because Noon Singh is actually supposed to be Indian.
Yeah, and I can actually support that argument because the Superman Wars are supposed to take place in 1996.
Right.
Long before, what's his name? Oh, God. I know
Ricardo Montalban?
No, long before, Eric Bana's, evil Romulan comes and fucks shit up.
Ah, okay.
So, yeah, technically speaking, he should still be Ricardo Montalban, but I don't know.
At least an Indian guy, because there's many, many very good Indian actors out there. I would have loved to have had a part. You know, jumping at a part to be in a big Hollywood movie, hell yeah.
Exactly. But it's one of those situations of, it's Star Trek.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still going to go for freaking ever. I mean, we're still hearing stuff from production about Star Trek 3.
Yeah.
In this news cycle. So, I'm not worried about Star Trek anytime soon going in the crapper.
I mean, hearing theories about, you know, there's going to be a web series called Star Trek Renegades.
Yeah.
And they're still talking about doing another TV series.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it happens or not, I don't know, but it would be interesting.
You know, I find it interesting the way that your theory about the Henson and Disney stuff is oddly prescient also here in Star Trek, where the founder dies and suddenly everything's in a bit of a disarray, and then a couple of people from those old hands are still there, and, you know, kind of bring it to a level that was there, but it's still in the spirit of the founder.
Yeah. Well, what I was saying is that you get everyone that's left around saying, oh, this is exactly how Disney would have done it, or this is how Henson would have done it.
Or this is how Roddenberry would have done it.
Right, but the next generation after that, the guys that had no, you know, physical connection with those creators, can say, no, I think this is how it made me feel when I was a kid.
Exactly.
And that's exactly how they make it, how amazing the shows end up. I mean, you know, the Muppets movie was really good.
Mm-hmm.
The Disney Renaissance, when they finally get rid of all the old, the nine old men. The guys that had worked for Disney for, you know, 50 years. Don't get me wrong, I love those guys. Because they had done some of the most amazing artwork of all time. But they needed a strong hand to rudder them. And during the 70s and early 80s, there was no strong hand. That's one reason why Disney floundered so hard. And I think you're about the same right with Star Trek. I mean, after Roddenberry died, you got Rick Berman and Brandon Braga, I think, almost had their own personal vendettas against Roddenberry.
Yeah.
And they wanted to make, okay, we're tired of being all happy and bouncy. Let's make everything dark and evil and rah. Let's have a war. Yeah, we're going to have a war. And now you've got J.J. Abrams, who, you know, I don't think he's going to have time to work on any more Star Trek.
Yeah, no. Considering he's doing Star Wars now,
no.
I've heard that he's not going to return to Star Trek ever.
Well, I think, was it you or was it Tim was telling me that one of the things that J.J. Abrams was, what has Star Wars taught us that we can use in Star Trek to make an exciting film?
Yeah, that's actually something that comes right out of the 2009 movie's documentary on how it's made.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's what can we learn from Star Wars, no matter how sacrilegious that may be.
Right.
And I think they've taken everything that they can learn from Star Wars and put it into these Star Trek movies.
Yeah. I think they've done a very good job. I mean, I'm gonna, one of these days I will sit down and watch Into the Darkness. I think my dad owns it.
Yeah.
But so, yeah. I'll see it, and then I'll see it about the same time I watch Age of Ultron. Yeah.
Oh, good.
No, I'll watch it at some point. I'll watch Age of Ultron probably this week.
Cool.
I'll go catch the matinee on Thursday or something. But yeah, what else can we say about Star Trek? I will say one thing, though.
Go for it.
Way back in the late 80s, early 90s, I used to read a magazine called Wizard.
Mm-hmm.
It was a comic book, it was about the comic book industry.
Yeah.
And one of the things they used to do was have dream casting for movies, for comic book movies.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they had, like, you know, Superman played by Tom Cruise, or Batman played by Tom Cruise, or Batman played by Harrison Ford, or something like that, you know, things
right.
like that.
Or they did Dark Knight Returns Batman with Clint Eastwood, or something like that.
Right, exactly. But they had a dream casting for, every 5 or 6 years, they'd have a dream casting for X-Men.
Mm-hmm.
And they had, like, David Duchovny as Cyclops, and Dolph Lundgren as Colossus, and so on and so forth. But the one running constant they always had from the beginning, when they first started doing this poll, to the end, was Patrick Stewart as Professor X.
Nice.
And guess who got the part?
Patrick Stewart.
I remember when they first did X-Men, when they first announced the X-Men movie, and they said Patrick Stewart was Professor X. I'm like, okay, I'm already in.
All right, I'll take 5.
Yep. I always feel so bad for poor Doug Gray Scott.
Yeah.
I don't know if I probably told the story on the show before, but well, Hugh Jackman has announced that he's no longer going to be Wolverine after the next Wolverine movie.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, he's had a 20-year run. He's done.
Right.
And he's going to go on to other parts. That's fine. You know, he's getting older.
Yeah.
So they're already talking about who they can, other parts, people that can recast as a part. And I just like, this is a joke I want to put in. How about Doug Gray Scott? Because he was the original choice for Wolverine.
Mm-hmm.
And it probably would have been a star-making role for him.
Oh, yeah.
But unfortunately, he had reshoots to do on Mission Impossible 2, so he had to drop out of the film, and they, you know, basically stuck Hugh Jackman in as an experiment to hope to God he could carry the movie. And sure enough, he could.
Oh, yeah.
And so now, you know, Hugh Jackman's one of the biggest movie stars in the world, and Doug Gray Scott is guest starring on Doctor Who. Don't get me wrong. Nothing wrong with that. But not exactly a step up in your career, Big Dog.
Oh, well. There was one other thing that I was going to ask you about on the show tonight.
Oh, sure.
So, the other day, we were at work, and you mentioned something about chasing somebody out of your apartment with a sword?
Yes, I did.
What the fuck?
Okay, set the Wayback Machine to the early 2000s. I was living with my roommate Jason, and Jason was out of town for a convention. So it was basically me and, you know, the television and my computer and a bottle of whiskey, and it was a great time. So I'm zonked out in my room. I don't think I was actually drunk that evening. And I hear someone jiggling the front door. Apparently I left it unlocked by accident.
Mm-hmm.
And I hear someone shuffling around in the living room. Like, oh, Jason must be home. And then that little voice in the back of your head that's always awake and always panicking goes, Jason's not due home for 2 days. And I went, someone's in my apartment. So I woke up, and I'm kind of looking around my room. It's all dark. I'm like, okay, someone's in my room. Someone's in my apartment. What do I do? So I pull on my jeans without bothering to put the buckle them up. So I'm basically, I'm bare-chested, wearing nothing but a pair of jeans, no shoes. And I open my door, and I go for the first weapon I can find. Now, do I go for my 9mm pistol? No. I go for a freaking broadsword. So I go out in the living room, you know, as quietly as possible, and there is a dude leaned over jacking our stereo. You know, he's pulling the wires, he's getting ready to take it out.
Right.
And I'm behind him with a sword. And, you know, in the movies are always like, you know, some badass line like, what do you think you're doing? Or I shall slay you for trying to oust my stereo. Or my name is Inigo Montoya. You touched my stereo. Prepare to die. But in my half awake state, all that comes out is, hey, what are you doing?
The guy turns and looks at me. All he sees is a dude with a pair of jeans that are falling around his hips because he doesn't have a belt on. Bare-chested with a freaking sword. And the guy's like, And I'm just like, and they scream at him. The guy drops the stereo. Thank God he didn't do any damage to it. And he runs out the front door. And I run after him, not thinking that this is a really, really bad idea. So it's pouring down rain. I hit the parking lot. He's taken off. I'm still screaming at the top of my lungs, waving my sword like a banshee. And then I hit gravel.
Oh no!
In bare feet. So basically, from what I can imagine, it sounded was like, ow, 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 and I turn around, and, like, you know, stumble back in my house, holding with one hand to my sword, the other hand holding my jeans up, showing my butt crack to everything as water rushes down. I'm getting soaked. And I finally, like, I lock the door, and I'm like, do I call the cops? No. So I wiped my sword off with a paper towel. I took a couple slugs of whiskey and I went back to bed.
Tell me you locked the door.
Yeah, I locked the door the second time, yes.
Okay, good.
So I just imagine this poor guy, you know, probably boosting the stereo to buy drugs or something. He's like talking to his friends like, oh man, it was crazy. This half-naked guy chased me out with a sword. So that was my chasing guy out with a sword story.
Okay. Well, because we really don't have Thou Shalt Not prepared for this episode, I actually did think of one that I kind of jacked from somebody else.
Okay.
Speaking of jacking things. And it also has to do with sharp implements.
Okay.
Namely, chainsaws.
Oh, dear.
So, the idea here is basically, Thou Shalt Not add with a chainsaw to this title. So, examples would be how to build a... To Build a Fire with a Chainsaw. Or Mark Twain's Tom Sawyer with a Chainsaw.
The Swan Princess with a Chainsaw. A Troll in Central Park with a Chainsaw.
Leprechaun with a Chainsaw.
I'd watch it.
yeah, me too.
The Grumpy Little Mermaid with a Chainsaw.
Grumpy Cat with a Chainsaw.
The Great Mouse Detective.
With a chainsaw.
Gone with the Wind. With a chainsaw.
Oh, it's beautiful.
Barton Fink. With a chainsaw.
The Big Lebowski. With a chainsaw.
With a chainsaw.
we could go on for hours like this, mm-hmm. You know.
Oh, God. let's see. Just like some political threats. 3 days of the Condor. And a chainsaw.
Three men and a baby. With a chainsaw.
A chainsaw. Get that chainsaw away from the baby. But she likes it. She's sleeping okay. It's that the humming's keeping me awake.
The Silence of the Lambs. With a chainsaw.
That just sounds like a bad horror film already.
Hannibal. With a chainsaw.
Hannibal with a chainsaw. Yes.
That would make things easier, I think.
Anastasia, with a chainsaw.
I would totally watch that. Rock and Rule, with a chainsaw. Manos the Hands of Fate, with a chainsaw.
Chainsaw Massacre, with a chainsaw. Oh, hey, wait. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, with a spatula.
Oh, that's beautiful. The Dark Knight Rises with a spatula up his ass with a chainsaw.
Oh, what's a spatula up my ass?
No, that is not where that goes! You are doing it wrong!
Zombieland with a chainsaw.
Isn't that already the movie?
Yeah, pretty much.
Scott Pilgrim versus the World with a chainsaw. Now the world has the chainsaw.
Yes. Dr. Horrible with a chainsaw. And when I say chainsaw, God. I mean my penis.
Of course.
Captain Hammer
with a chainsaw.
Oh, God. Dr. Horrible with a chainsaw.
The 16 Candles with a chainsaw. The Breakfast Club with a chainsaw.
Ferris Bueller's Day Off with a chainsaw. The chainsaw.
Oh, God.
You don't want to let me into this restaurant, huh?
Nymphomaniac with a chainsaw.
Oh, God. Lolita with a chainsaw.
Nymphomaniac with a chainsaw just sounds like a bad exploitation movie.
Yeah, it does.
Pardon me.
So, yeah.
Batman with a chainsaw.
I think that should do it for us.
Can you bleed?
Do you bleed?
You know, the chainsaw is made out of kryptonite.
Of course. So if you would like to participate in Thou Shalt Not Tonight, hashtag LNTD 22, and hashtag Thou Shalt Not. Remember, it's Thou Shalt Not Have This Title with a Chainsaw.
With a chainsaw.
Late night taco delivery with a chainsaw.
With a chainsaw. We make your tacos with chainsaws. Better Off Dead with a chainsaw. I'm just going through my movie list right now and just adding with a chainsaw.
Star Wars with a chainsaw.
So, Phantom Empire with a chainsaw.
Raiders of the Lost Ark with a chainsaw.
With a chainsaw.
The Temple of Doom with a chainsaw. Kalima!
Tucker and Dale versus Evil. Well, they already have a chainsaw.
I fucking love that movie.
Oh, it is so damn funny.
Oh, man. I actually bought it recently. It's over at the store.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yep. $5.
Yeah, it's worth it.
Oh, yeah, totally.
All right, man.
Yeah. So from all of us here at Radioactive Walrus Entertainment, The Recording Closet, and Dan's House.
Hello.
This has been Late Night Taco Delivery. Thank you for calling.
You may now place your order.
Late Night Taco Delivery is performed by Daniel Gill and Jonathan Knoll, and was created by Daniel Gill. New Bizarre Opening by Jonathan Knoll. If you have questions, comments, or a suggestion for a future show, drop us a line on Twitter at Radio Walrus Pod. Like Radioactive Walrus Entertainment on our Facebook, or subscribe to our official YouTube channel, Radioactive Walrus. That's Radioactive with a capital R, Walrus with a capital W, and no spaces. Thank you for calling Late Night Taco Delivery. You may now place your orders. This has been a production of Radioactive Walrus Entertainment.
John, what do chickens say?